الحمد لله، الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، صدق الله العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. دروس شيخ الله. Respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters listening at home, in the last session of Darsi Hadith, we covered the final onslaught of the Muslim army, where Musaylamah al-Kazzab's army was completely defeated. The famous garden Hadithat al-Maut, the garden of death, this site between Ahle Haqq and Ahle Batil was the most ferocious, vicious and bloodiest in the history of Islam. Just in one day, as many as 10,000 kuffar were killed, Musaylamah al-Kazzab's army, in the garden of death, Hadithat al-Maut, where they were trapped. And Muslims also received a heavy loss. 1,200 great warriors, Mujahideen, were shaheed. And amongst them, what was extremely painful for Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq at the time, who was the Khalifa, the 70 or 80 of them were most famous Qurra and Huffaz, close companions to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They also became shaheed. It is at this moment, after the event of the Battle of Yamama, Hazrat Umar Farooq said to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq that we need to compile all the different parts and portions of the Quran which are scattered and to unify everything in a book form. I think we have covered that jama'ah of the Quran in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Nevertheless, when the fight was over, later on when some of the people of Banu Hanifa, that is the tribe of Musaylamah al-Kazzab, when they met up with Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was just amazed to see some of the people in the tribe to have great understanding, learned people. They did hear of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was amazed at how could someone follow Musaylamah al-Kazzab. So he said to some of the people that were there, read to me some of the verses which al-iyazu billah Musaylamah said that it was a revelation that came to him. So some of them from Banu Hanifa said that, Amirul Mu'mineen, it is better that you just leave that out. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq insisted. He said, no, I want to hear that what made your entire tribe in the northern part of Arabia follow this man Musaylamah al-Kazzab. So some of them read some of the so-called verses that the shaitan had inspired him. What he would do is he would imitate and change some of the verses of the Quran. For an example, someone said to him that Surah Al-Kawthar was revealed to Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwal abtar. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Huzul alayhi salatu wa salam's honor, that Allah has given him the fountain of Kawthar. What Musaylama would do, he would say, well, similar words in Revelation have also come to me, like I told you that it is a 50-50% share. And he said to me, the verses that were revealed was, Inna a'atainaka al-miftah, fasalli lirabbika wartah, fasalli lirabbika wartah. And this is what the kuffar have been doing. What they do is they change the words of the Quran from one ayah to another ayah and just produce something which has no significance, no meaning, which does not fit the Arabic grammar at all. And there's always a group of people out there that is prepared to pick up any rubbish that you throw on the street. So anything that's out there, they're prepared to pick up. So you always have that following. And Musaylamah al-Kazzab, he also had a jinn in him. He would mesmerize people. Like I said, that when he would speak, he would hypnotize people. And he had a massive following from all those that claimed prophethood. He had the biggest following in Arabia at that time. Hazrat Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was not a Muslim, he met up with Musaylamah al-Kazzab and said to him that, read for me some of the verses that you claim is a revelation to you. And he looked at Musaylamah al-Kazzab. Now, the Arabs were also well versed in the Arabic language. And he said, oh, the verses revealed to me is, Ya Wabar, fa'innaka iznani wa sadar. So Hazrat Amr ibn al-As looked at him and said to him, you know and I know that you are a liar. You know and I know that you are a liar. And Musaylamah al-Kazzab just looked at Amr ibn al-As. But yet you see, like I said, you have a lot of juhala. People will just flock to you. Anything you give them, they are prepared. And you will have a following. This is what a lot of people have done in the subcontinent, who have become so-called peers and who have taken advantage of the Muslims and have set up their own empires, and they have their own personal bodyguard and an army. Subhanallah. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that protects. Just to give you one example why people would follow Musaylamah al-Kazzab. There was this old man who came to Musaylamah, and Musaylamah said to him that, you're an old man, before you die, believe in me that I am the messenger and Allah will give you Jannah. So this old man said that, I'm not going to believe you like that. Give me proof. Show me proof so that I can believe you. And he read some verses again which he made up in the Arabic language. And this old man said that, the truth is, I know what you have read in front of me is all lies. But I would rather believe a liar, but from my tribe, than a truthful man, but from Quraysh. Do you understand what I'm saying, brother? This is how the mentality was, very much into tribalism. If there was a man from their tribe, they would not look at what is haqq or what is wrong, what is batil. They are prepared to follow him. Why? Because he is one amongst us. And Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam is a Qurayshi, and Musaylamah al-Kazzab is from the tribe of Banu Hanifa. So they were people who were prepared to believe Musaylamah al-Kazzab, and that is how he won the hearts of his people. He had the quality as an individual. He did have this great power of speech, jarbe lisan, a great orator. When he would speak, he would make sure that he would force people to believe in him. That was how he would speak. A bit like Adolf Hitler. They say that he was a great speaker also, and that he would practice his speech in an area where there was empty space, a massive empty space, and there would probably be boxes, empty boxes there, and he'd imagine it to be a lot of people in front of him, and he would practice his speech, and that is how he started. And people would listen to him, who probably not even seen Hitler in front of their eyes, but yet when he would speak, they would believe him. So this is not the dalil of someone being a truthful person. This is just, again, everything gift comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have Muslims who are wealthy, you also have kuffar who are wealthy. Muslims who have good character, and you might even find non-Muslims who have good character. So nevertheless, victory was with the Muslimin. It was Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala at the end that took the Muslims all the way to victory by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allama Tabari rahmatullah alayhi says that Khalid bin Walid was such a mujahid. He was so strong that when he would be out there in the front, the words of Allama Tabari in the Arabic language is Ya'kulu kullu shay, Ya'kulu kulli shay, that he would eat up anything that was in front of him. So there was nothing that would stand in front of Hazrat Khalid bin Walid, and he was the one who broke that wall that was there covering Musaylamatul Kazab. When I say eat everything, I mean that he would just remove everyone and kill everyone that was at sight. This is how courageous, how powerful Hazrat Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was a great warrior, a great mujahid, the sword of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Asadullah. This was a title that Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had given to Hazrat Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Inshallah, in tonight's session, I just want to go over some of the shuhada of this battle of Yamama. The first shaheed, Hazrat Thabit bin Qais radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Thabit bin Qais, a great mujahid, he was the Amir of the Ansar in this battle of Yamama. If you recall, he was the one who dug a hole and he put himself inside, and he said to his people that there is no army in the world that is going to push me back. I am going to fight from here. So Hazrat Thabit bin Qais radiallahu ta'ala an was also a shaheed in this battle, a great sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One particular incident with regards to the shahadat of Hazrat Thabit bin Qais is that when he passed away, someone saw a dream, a companion, that Hazrat Thabit bin Qais came to him and said to him that I have a very special valuable shield, and that shield has been taken by so and so Muslim, and he has placed my shield near his saddle. So what I want you to do is to go and take my shield and present that shield to Hazrat Khalid bin Walid, and tell Hazrat Khalid bin Walid to give this shield to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, and tell Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq to sell my shield, and the money that he receives he has to pay to so and so person because I owe them that much of money. That is the debt on me, on so and so person. So what I want you to do is to sell my shield and pay off my debt. Allahu Akbar. And in the dream, Hazrat Qais bin Thabit said that make sure, don't think that this dream is just something trivial, that you don't pay any attention to it. This is something very, very serious for me, so do exactly what I tell you to do. And when he woke up, exactly instructions that were given to him, he found the shield exactly where Hazrat Thabit bin Qais told him, and he took it to Hazrat Khalid bin Walid. Hazrat Khalid bin Walid took the shield. This was his karamat. And he took it to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq eventually sold that shield and he paid off on behalf of Hazrat Zayd bin Qais radiallahu, Thabit bin Qais radiallahu ta'ala an. This is his karamat. Again, one thing we learn from the hadith is how important it is to repay the people. Now it's not just about taking money and that is it, forget about it. Where if you take money from someone, then it is important that you repay that person. This is the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now even being a great mujahid, because this was Hukuk al-Ibad, and he had that shield with him, subhanallah, even by the means of dreams. As the Thabit bin Qais radiallahu ta'ala an, subhanallah, wanted to free himself from that burden that was upon him. Another thing what we have to understand is also that when your tongue is sidq, as in a truthful tongue, if you speak the truth, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show you dreams that are of a true nature, which have a lot of meaning. So if you are truthful, if you speak the truth, then the dreams you see are also truthful and also have a meaning. That is why if you read the kutub, you will notice that mujahideen, those who fight in the path of Allah in jihad, this is one unique group that whenever they sleep, Allah blesses them with a dream. Why? Because they are so truthful that they have no love for this dunya. They have sacrificed their family members, their children, their wealth, everything that belongs to them. And they are prepared to give up their own life for the sake of Allah. So, subhanAllah, one can imagine how sincere that person must be. That is why many of them in that condition always have this great maqam that they see Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their dreams. Sahaba-i kiram ajma'een were all mujahid and mujahideen, and it was always the habit of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that after Fajr Salah he would look at them and would say to them, has any one of you seen a dream? And Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam would listen to their dreams and would give them a meaning. So majority of the mujahideen. That is why it is very difficult to understand the thinking of that person who has spent all his life in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because what he sees is something completely different from what we see. We live in Leicester. We have a car to travel, we have everything there, we have a luxurious life. So we can't imagine how it is for them. So we don't know how it feels when the companions were saying that Qultu wa Rabbil Ka'ba, that I can see all the doors of Jannah open in front of me, completely open in front of me. This is only the sifat of Mujahideen, subhanallah al-azim. Nobody can understand that. We can only speak أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ نَعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ. So the Mujahideen, alhamdulillah, they have great honor. That is why Sahaba-i kiram ajma'een, subhanallah al-azim, when someone passed away also, they would rank him by his position in jihad. That is he from the Sahaba who were present in Badr, in Uhud, in Khandaq. And this is how each of the companions were ranked. So if somebody would say something, the companion would say, beware what you speak. Why? Because he's a Badri Sahabi. This is what they would say. He's a Badri Sahabi. And what is a Badri Sahabi? The companions that were with Huzur alayhi salatu was salam in Badr. So their rank was very high. And another Sahabi also was Hazrat Tufail al-Dawlasi. He said to his son one day that, oh my son, your father will become shaheed because I have seen a dream. And shahadat was given to him in this battle of Yamama. He says that in my dream I saw that someone came and he shaved my head. And after that I saw a bird flying out from my mouth. And this is dream again. Bird flying out from the mouth. And then after that I was swallowed in the womb of this lady that was in front of me, going back into the womb. This is a dream. So he said to his son that this is my shahadat. So the son said, father, how is this your shahadat? He said that my head being shaven is the meaning of it is that I will be shaheed, and the bird that comes out from my mouth is the ruh that will come out from my body, and that someone, a womb, I'm swallowed back into the womb of this lady means that I will be buried. I will be buried. And exactly this is what happens with Hazrat Tufail al-Dawlafi in the battle of Yamama. So a lot of the great companions were shaheed. One great Sahabi again was the brother of Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, whose name was Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab. He was very, very close to Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It is said that when news came to Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was with Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was pleased, of course, that the brother has, subhanallah, got that maqam, that ranking of shahadat, he is a shaheed. But he would remember him frequently. It is said when the wind would blow from the northern side of Madinatul Munawwara, Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab would say that I remember my brother, why the battle took place in Yamama, which was in northern Arabia. So he would frequently remember Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab. He would say that my brother had the quality and he beat me in two things. He was a great man. He said that Zaid embraced Islam before me, before Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he said that Allah gave him shahadat before me. So these are the two qualities that my brother has superseded me in. And not to forget that the son of Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab was also in this battle of Yamama, whose name was Hazrat Abdullah. Hazrat Abdullah, he returned back with Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and when he came back to Madinatul Munawwara, what would we do when we see someone alive coming back? We would embrace him and we would say Alhamdulillah, we would make a lot of dua, Allah Pak, take you Sahih Salim and you come back Sahih Salim. And Hazrat Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a different man. When he saw his son Hazrat Abdullah, he called his son and he said to him, how dare you come in front of me alive? Allah. His father would say that to his son, only Umar ibn al-Khattab. How dare you come in front of me alive? Your uncle is shaheed and you are alive. Subhanallah al-Azim. These were mujahid. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَزِرُ. Every drop of blood was for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their sincerity, their khulus, subhanallah. The Quran praises them in every para. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقَّ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. So Hazrat Abdullah comes to his father and he said, oh my dear father, I tried very hard. I even went right in the front. But it was not in my taqdeer, in my muqaddar, oh my dear father. Maybe Allah has reserved this shahadat for another day for me. So please excuse me. Please excuse me. And when Hazrat Umar Farooq heard this from him, he says, okay. But my tamanna was that you would have achieved that great maqam what Allah has given to your uncle, Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. These were Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'een, full of khulut. Another Sahabi was the brother of Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab. Now when I say brother, this was the brotherhood that Huzur alayhi salatu was salam made between Ansar and Muhajir. So Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab was a Muhajir Sahabi, and Huzur alayhi salatu was salam said to Hazrat Ma'an bin Uday that you are an Ansari, you are the brother of Zaid bin Khattab. And they took this literally. When Huzur alayhi salam would say brothers, that would mean brothers in everything. That would even mean that they would inherit something from him if something was to happen. But this was later on abrogated. So both of them were the best of friends and also brothers. And they were so close to each other that Allah kept them together all the time. Both of them were also shaheed at the same time on the same day. Hazrat Zaid bin Khattab and Hazrat Ma'an bin Uday. In the books of history, one statement which Hazrat Ma'an bin Uday made is very famous. Hazrat Ma'an bin Uday, when Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam passed away, a lot of the companions were in a state of shock, and some of them said that it would have been better for us to die than to see this day that Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away. Ma'an bin Uday was the only Sahabi who spoke out loudly in front of all the companions. He says, this is something which I don't wish. I would want to stay alive even after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are steadfast, like how we were steadfast in the time of Rasulullah. Even after his death, we are firm to his deen and to his teaching. So this was a very famous statement that came from Hazrat Ma'an bin Uday radiallahu ta'ala. Another great Sahabi who was also shaheed, subhanallah, was Hazrat Abu Dujana. Hazrat Abu Dujana was an incredible character. He was the hero of Badr. The man who was so brave, he put on a red band on his head and he took his sword out. And from one end to the other end where the kuffar were, he would lift up his chest with his sword and he would march in front of them. And he would march in a very arrogant way. And he would speak out and he would say, Dujana is ready for you. Oh disbelievers, Dujana is ready for you. And I am waiting for you. And Dujana is ready for you. This was the iman they had. So some of the companions says, Abu Dujana, this is an arrogant walk, that you walk in this way. In Islam, walking in that manner is not right. You should be humble. And this news reached Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it is true that in the case of the style, the method of how Abu Dujana walks, this is arrogance, pride, and it is not allowed for anyone of the Ummah to walk in this manner, but Allah has informed me for Abu Dujana it is jayz to walk like this. Subhanallah. What great companion. It is jayz for Abu Dujana to walk like this. Why? To instill fear in the hearts of the kuffar. This is what Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that when you do tawaf of the Kaaba, mushrikeen in Makkah were sitting on the mountains and they would say, you see, the heat of Makkah has proven to be too great for the Muslimin. They can't bear the heat, and now the Muslims are very weak. So Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no, put your ihram, take it out, show your right arm and march like soldiers. March like soldiers. So when you do tawaf, this is what you do. You march like soldiers. And this is only for men, not for women. Although nowadays some of the women do want to march like soldiers, and they can push you out. But it is only for men. Subhanallah. So Abu Dujana was that great Sahabi who also was shaheed in this battle of Yamama. Now, we can't forget Abu Dujana. Why? Abu Dujana's got a share of Musaylamatul Kazzab. Now, there were a lot of people whose aim and target was Musaylama. One of them was also Abu Dujana. So some of them have said that Musaylamatul Kazzab was killed by Hazrat Wahshi radiallahu ta'ala and other companions which we have mentioned. But Abu Dujana also had his fair share of attacking Musaylamatul Kazab. So these are great companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Abbad radiallahu ta'ala was another Sahabi who fought on that day very courageously, and he was a brave soldier. In fact, whenever people remembered the day of Yamama, an example was given of Hazrat Abbad bin Bishr radiallahu ta'ala an, that the day belonged to Abbad bin Bishr. Now Abbad bin Bishr was a Sahabi who got shahadat in the battle of Yamama. It is said about Hazrat Abbad bin Bashir that once Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Masjid Nabwi in the night, and he was in the hujra of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. صلى الله عليه وسلم had beautiful recitation of the Quran in the masjid. So Abu Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Hazrat Aisha, Ya Aisha, is this not Abbad bin Bishr reciting the Quran? And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala an, after listening to the qiraat, said, Ya Rasulullah, I think it is Abbad bin Bishr that is reciting the Quran. So Abu Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at that time said, Rahimahullah, that may Allah have mercy on him. May Allah have. Now, whenever the words of mercy would come out from the mouth of Rasulullah, that would mean in the language of the companions that shahadat will be with him. So if Huzur alayhi salam said, "Bhai Allah tum par raham kare," sahaba knew that this man will become shaheed. For them, the greatest raham and mercy in the language of the companions and in the language of the Quran and Hadith, the words that came out from Rasulullah that may Allah have mercy meant that may Allah give you shahadat, because shahadat is the greatest mercy. Aaj koi kisi ko keh de ji Allah paak tum par raham farmaye, karam farmaye, Allah tumhe shaheed kar de, to wo kahega bhai ajeeb aadmi hai bhai, kamal ka aadmi. And he knew that these are the words that came out from the mouth of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shahadat is with him. It is said that in one of the battles, one of the Ansari Sahabi who would prepare the nasheed for the battles, and Allah had given him that voice, and he would sing with the Muslimin like Hassan bin Thabit to give them that power to fight the Muslimin and even the camels and the horses that were there. And they had this special manner of reciting poetry. So there was this one Ansari Sahabi who was doing the reading, the nasheed, and Huzur alayhi salam looked at him and said, Subhanallah, Allah has given him a beautiful voice. And Huzur alayhi salam said, may Allah show mercy to him. May Allah show. And Hazrat Umar Farooq came to Huzur alayhi salam, Ya Rasulallah, but this Ansari Sahabi, great man, beautiful voice, we wanted him to stay alive for a long time. Huzur alayhi salam says, no, may Allah have mercy. Hazrat Umar Farooq says that he was shaheed straight away. He got shahadat straight away. Subhanallah. And imagine, Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam was on one of the mountains, and the mountain started to move, a tremor that was there, an earthquake. Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam was there, and Abu Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Uthbut, that whilst the Nabi is on top of you, and this is your condition, Uthbut, be firm, فَإِنَّ عَلَيْكَ نَبِيٌ وَصِدِّيقٌ وَالشَّهِيدَانِ, that on top of you is a Nabi and a Siddiq. And he said, two Shaheed. Who is the Nabi? Rasulullah. Who is the Siddiq? The Siddiq was never to be Shaheed because his nisbat was with Huzur alayhi salam. So the kuffar could never say, you see, that we assassinated him. So his nisbat was with Hazrat Rasulullah. So his condition was different because he was a Siddiq. And then Huzur alayhi salam says, was Shaheedan, and the two Shaheed, Amr ibn al-Khattab, and who else? Hazrat Asman radiallahu ta'ala. And the companions knew this is prophecy. Hazrat Umar Farooq knew very well that these are the words that came out from Rasulullah, and shahadat will be given to me. Aap log thak gaye? Brothers are tired? I think you're tired. So I was just going to talk about Hazrat Khalid bin Walid nikah, but inshaAllah ta'ala we'll continue with this in the next session. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to make amal on what has been said. InshaAllah, these are just some of the companions, what happens to Hazrat Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala an. We will inshaAllah cover that in the next session. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Dua salli. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa maulana Muhammadin nabiyil ummi wa ala alihi wa sallim taslima. Allahumma taqabbal minna wa tub alayna innaka antat tawwabur rahim. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al'afwa wal afiyata fid dunya wal akhirah. Allahumma inna nas'aluka min ridaka wal jannah wa na'udhu bika min ghadabika wan nar. Wa na'udhu bika min ghadabika wan nar. Salli ala wa ta'ala ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir bi rahmatika ya rahmar rahim.